Okay, so Michael and I have stuff to report from TC53 and from an internal CES meeting we had yesterday where we came to agreement on some change in the design. What else do people have to talk about?
I would like to cover some of the changes that we're making on the rounds proposal so we can start ironing them out before the next meeting. I think you have reviewed some of them, but just getting to some conclusion there and move on. And aside from that, we have the conversation, pending conversation about intrinsics and primordials. And we can also, I'm not prepared to talk about, to follow up on the conversation from last week, but maybe we can do that the next week.
Okay.
I kind of have, again, another tangent topic. So it might not necessarily be ready for this meeting, but I've noticed there's, at least Brad mentioned, I think, on Wednesday. So there are loader threads now, and this is a reality in JavaScript. It's going to affect platforms, implementations, and at least in Node.js, we are running into some, questions on how to design something. My concern is if we want to go with a loader design that is for a language that is portable. We should try to see if the loader design is not going to make the portability suffer. If you're going to have to ship different loaders for all the different cases, you're going to use some sort of a solution. So if Brad is Brad, are you able to pick this up in this meeting, or do we just make it an agenda item for a future one?
I'm not entirely sure what the concerns are. They don't necessarily need to be threaded, but you can encounter deadlock, which is generally, I find, acceptable for a large number of people. The thing that we're talking about here is Node's ES modules are trying to move all the loaders to separate thread for a few reasons. One is isolation, which is the key. You could run a loader in the same thread or agent as your body of code, but isolation is still proving fairly important. But we're also moving them so that multiple agents can reuse the same loader because spinning one up is cost prohibitive, at least in our experience so far. So, yeah.
I'm definitely interested on learning more about that. I do have opinions about loaders, so I would like to hear more about it.
Okay, and there's also some insights about the whole loading thing that comes from our recent work on CES and especially in the TC53 context. So good. So that's probably something we're going to hit from several different angles. And Bradley, I see that you also put in chat a thing about Node is looking at some censoring some APIs like object.prototype.dunderproto.
Yes. So
What
there are a few
does censoring mean to that?
that we are not quite sure because people are arguing. In general, just removal of the accessor for that one. But there are a variety of CVEs that have come out as results of APIs, even when we have frozen intrinsics available, the CVEs would still be affected by some APIs. So in particular, under proto on object prototype is particularly nasty. And the vast majority of CVEs that come out in a way that are not mostly mitigated by freezing the intrinsics.
So the if you remove Dunder Proto, and we did design it so that it can be removed, But we still have in the language reflect.getPrototypeOf and reflect.setPrototypeOf. So there's no loss of power if you're removed under proto. Put it another way, there's no dangerous thing you can do with dunder proto that you cannot do if dunder proto is removed.
Correct. This is a usability problem. The API design of dunder proto means that all objects, when you assign to the underscore underscore proto underscore underscore property, if they inherit from big O object and they aren't from a JSON.parse, essentially they call this accessor pair. And that is where all the CVEs are coming from. People are doing things like using JSON.parse, and somebody's uploading a malicious, sometimes not even intentionally malicious, JSON with a underscore underscore proto key within a JSON object. And that is going through and causing people to get prototype pollution. Okay. And there are exploits for this. Kibana had an exploit where people could get some privilege escalation on their front end, which that's a different question about the design of that. But this is in the wild, and while it isn't a new power, we're not removing any capability of the language itself by doing this. It is removing the usability problem that is causing these CVEs. It changes it from where you have to write defensive programming and know about the problem to you would have to use those, you know, out of band APIs to do it.
Okay, I'm sympathetic to that. As I said, we did design it on purpose so that it could be removed.
My hunch on this is that there will be issues with this removal.
So we are running a few tests. Different people are doing different things. The actual removal is very hard to tell what it causes to fail.
Right, right. That's the biggest challenge here. Like, you remove it, you don't necessarily get anything meaningful out of testing it, but it's an observable difference that people might run into it with the programs that they have. So
one thing that we're trying to figure out is what tracing we want to do, because just removal is not sufficient for testing the viability of it. The actual corpus of source code relying on that exact property is fairly low, actually, and most of it simply just should be able to be ported machine-wise.
We're diving into this while we were exploring agendas, but I think this is a quick one, so I don't mind. One of the things that you could do that would prevent silent misbehavior that would result from just removing it for legacy programs is replace the setter with a setter that always throws.
We can do that. Another idea was to do a full abort. Others were logging, but in general, I feel that full abort, since this is trying to detect the altered behaviors being problematic, is extreme. Logging is probably fine, but causing it to throw would not match the behavior when we do just remove it, if we do that path. So,
So good. I think we've come to an understanding on this one. While we still have Michael Hunter here, why don't we talk some about TC53 and the report from there? So I did I presented my SES talk, essentially the talk that I gave at the last TC39 meeting, kind of mashed up with my preserve virtualizability talk, also from the last meeting. Explained what CES for devices looks like as something that I think is a very clear target that we're pretty much ready to specify now, while still having some things to work out with regard to how CES fits into overall JavaScript. Because in the TC53 context, there's some things that we don't need to solve, the typical TC53 context, some things that we don't need to solve because you're not starting with a JavaScript system. You're just running a CES machine. Whereas for having the CES proposal ready to advance at TC39, we have to work out all of the issues of how it integrates with the larger JavaScript language. I presented that. We spent the rest of the afternoon on Tuesday talking about CES. I thought that went very well. There's an important new insight that came from Michael Hunter that fits with the way Agoric was planning to use CES, but we didn't think of it quite in this way, which is XS has this build time and where you're running with the primordials unfrozen so that you can run trusted customization code. Trust is always a confusing term. So we say vetted customization code. You're running ahead of any code you choose to run ahead of time. There is code that everything afterwards is completely vulnerable to. So it has to be one that you've vetted and are willing to use to customize the environment, like a shim, and like just early execution that sets things up. XS has this snapshot that freezes all the primordials and snapshots the heap, including the modules that had already been initialized, such that then execution resumes from the snapshotted heap on the device. So basically, the snapshotted heap, together with the equivalent of the static module records for all of the pre-compiled modules that you pre-compile at build time, that all of those go into ROM, and then you, in the device, you revive from there and you continue execution with the frozen primordials. In the SES proposal, we've identified that we've created a portable semantics for that freezing event, which we call lockdown, which is as of lockdown, the result of calling lockdown is that you now have a full SES environment prepared for untrusted code after the lockdown. So the primordials are frozen and all the dangerous built-in behaviors have been repaired. And you've got a fully working compartment API for creating new compartments as isolation boundaries. What Michael Hunter noticed is that the freezing for enabling you to run untrusted code, for example, just third-party libraries that you want to run under least authority, that doesn't have to be the end of your build time execution. It's just that once you've locked down, you can now execute code you don't trust, but you might still want to run some of that ahead of time, like third-party libraries, until that execution reaches the stable point where you then want to snapshot the heap. So I thought it was very interesting to separate those and to be able to snapshot the heap sometime after the lockdown, after you've loaded third-party libraries, snapshot the heap, and then resume execution from the snapshotted heap on the device.
Yes, thanks, Mark. I'm about to board the plane, so if I duck out, that's probably why. but I think what you've described is quite accurate in terms of what Metalscript is doing. It's got this virtual machine that runs at build time that pre-executes pre-executes the JavaScript, but it can actually execute past any particular phase, like a lockdown. We don't have lockdown in Metalscript at the moment, but that's the way it's intending to work. I can't speak on behalf of XS, though. I'm not sure how the preload system works, where they are pre-compiling essentially where they're freezing that virtual machine into a state that can be downloaded to ROM. But definitely, I agree with the general sentiment.
Yeah. So the it would still be the case that in the typical embedded configuration, I would assume both for Metalscript and for XS, and generally for what I'm calling typical TC53, is that you would still have pre-compiled all of the JavaScript code that's going to run before you snapshot for cutting ROM, so that the resulting system on the typical device does not need a JavaScript parser and scope analyzer and compiler. It doesn't need to be able to go from source text to execution. It doesn't have to have the machinery to do that on the device.
Yes, that's true, and also I think an advantage is that you can construct compartments ahead of time, which is something I don't believe you can do if you lock down at the same time that you kind of freeze the system into a ROM image. You can construct compartments ahead of time, then they technically don't consume any runtime overhead.
Right. So I think that's actually where it came up, is that Peter, realizing that he needed to, in order to do least authority cross compartment linkage, he needed to wait until he had compartments to load some modules. So he had to create more compartments and more modules that were initialized on the device. He was paying for the particular scenario an additional 16K of memory that he didn't used to be paying. And if you could do that second phase still before you snapshot, then that 16K would go back into being in ROM. So I think, I don't want to speak for XS, but it did come up at the meeting. And my sense was that we would all be receptive to TC53 proceeding under the assumption that the lockdown and the snapshot could be separated in that way. Michael, your audio is terrible. We're getting weird latency and dropout.
I think he's boarded the plane.
Okay. Nobody else can hear Michael? Michael Hunter?
Nope.
Okay. Well, good. Glad you could join us, Michael, and looking forward to your future participation. Another thing that happened at TC53 is we've been going back and forth with regard to two aspects of mapping module names and whether we do it with one map or two maps. And in the Agoric internal SES meeting yesterday, we came to agreement in where I hoped we were going, where the discussion started in TC53. So I'm going to bring up the slides from my talk and go over that and see if this group as well feels good with the mapping proposal that I think I like. Ah, did Michael just rejoin us? Michael Hunter, did you just rejoin us?
Okay. Sorry, I was muted. Yeah, I think my signal's a bit poor here. I think the summary of what I was saying, it's just that I'm unsure of what's possible at this stage.
Michael, your audio was unclear. I did not get the gist of what you were saying. Okay. Are people seeing a presentation
yes.
showing an MMU and such things?
Yes.
Okay. Let's see, there's a chat. Michael Hunter in chat says, signal is poor, summary is I'm unsure what can be done in excess. Okay, good. And I also see in the chat a question from, actually a suggestion from Caridi of an agenda item. Can someone explain the why on this one? Good. So symbol open close, notice it's written without the nu. Symbol open close produces a symbol, which is a primitive value. It is not an object, and as a primitive value, it is in no way realm specific. So if you did the same experiment with a quoted string or a number, if you say, you know, quote x unquote, dot constructor dot dunder proto, what's happening is that the string itself is a primitive value, and it is completely not specific to any realm. But when you say dot on the string, you know, dot property name like dot constructor, what happens is in the semantics of JavaScript, and the same thing happens with symbol. In the semantics of JavaScript, it uses the realm associated with the running code, the actual code that says dot constructor is code that is executing in some realm, and the dot is the semantics of it is that a string wrapper object is constructed around the string. In strict mode, this is completely unobservable. So I'll skip talking about the wrapper object. The wrapper object has no own properties. The wrapper object being, you know, unobservable and not capturable and without own properties, the important thing is that new wrapper of the executing code's realm inherits from the string.prototype of the executing code's realm. So the dot constructor gets looked up on that realm's string.prototype, the dot constructor is the string constructor, and the string constructor being a constructor of a particular realm, it inherits from the function dot prototype of that realm. So exactly the same thing's going on here.
Right.
The symbol open close gives you a symbol value. The dot constructor looks up the symbol constructor associated with the running code, and et cetera, et cetera. It's exactly the same thing. There's no special case for symbols here. And just like our membranes never remap strings or numbers, they should never remap symbols.
Right, yeah. I figured that. The question was, is these something that, because obviously when you do a string value there or something else that doesn't look like a function call, is easy to understand. Is this somehow, maybe we can add some notes into the spec or something. Maybe, I don't know,
some just clarification. A non-normative note to clarify?
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah, non-normative should be fine. Something like that, we could probably send a pull request or something.
Yeah, sure.
Because at first glance, I was like, okay, well, I'm not sure what's going on here. After spending time discussing with a few folks, we came to the conclusion that that's correct. The other thing that was very interesting for me is that obviously in the scheme, in the realm scheme, this was leaking the object from the outside of the sandbox because the width will not capture this lookup.
Right. This is an undeniable lookup.
Yeah.
It's basically you're reaching the string dot prototype, or in this case, the symbol dot prototype, by syntax rather than by scope lookup.
Yep. So it affects us in that sense as well.
Okay.
But in the new thing that we're working on, because we have multiple realms instead of compartments, because we're in different realms, then everything is fine. Because in the realm itself is going to get the function constructor of that realm rather than the outer realm in this case.
Okay, and I mean when you say because it's realms rather than compartments, there's no problem at all in compartments. Because in compartments, it's all just
you
in share, one
you
realm.
Share that. Yeah, you share that. Yes.
Yeah. There's not even a potential confusion issue there with compartments. So are we done on this one? Is that pretty much?
I also need a note for big int.
All primitive values have exactly the same behavior with regard to this issue, including big int, with regard to it looking like a function call, the symbol thing, you can also call the string constructor. If you call it without new, you get back, basically it acts like a coercer. If you say string open paren 33 close paren, you get the string 33 rather than the number 33, but it's just a string value if you called string without new. So it really is just directly parallel to what's happening with string.
Yep.
Okay. So back to this.
Mark, before you go into this one, do you want to cover the two issues that the two pull requests open for the round proposal quickly? The one that you
sure
you did a review on that already, just to get everyone on the same page.
Okay. Yeah. I like the as I probably just demonstrated, I do like the strategy of covering things that are quick first, just to get more of them done. So go ahead. Should I stop? Why don't I stop sharing and you can share?
I was just planning to put it in the chat.
You should go ahead and I do see it in the chat, but you should go ahead and share since you'll be speaking to it.
Sure, this one. Let me see when you see it.
I see it.
Okay, so two pull requests that we have open.
You could make it a little bit larger.
Two pull requests that are open on the run proposal. The first one is to introduce the import method. This is to allow people to still import a module even if you have CSP enabled and such. And the only detail here that is still TBD for me. So I think Mark's comment here of what would be the reference script or module when you're trying to import that way. So you do something, I think I have an example somewhere. Where is it? Maybe here. Where is it? I can type it. So you have something like cons is a new realm. Now you're doing realm import something. The problem is that what will be the referral module or source in order to compute the resolution of something like this. So you go with something like this, then probably it's going to be easier because you're not doing a relative import. But if you do this, what does it mean? And in the context of what you're trying to do here, it's still weird that we're just passing null value to it as part of the importing sequence. I don't know the answer to this one. I think it's still, I'm trying to find prior art to this. I suspect that node, when you do execute a node using a module as your program, how does that work? Does it have a null reference? Well, in that case, the resolution of the program file system location is happening before nodes actually try to import the thing. So in that case, it's not really prior art to this in the web itself.
There are two paths that node takes. For the entry point, which is the more relevant here, I would say, we do resolve it before, we do a path resolution, not a URL or module resolution, before we hand it to the loader for your main entry point. That's one path that gets taken. However, there's a different path for the --- require flag where we don't do that. In which case it is relative to a magic current working directory lookup using the module resolution. That makes sense. So we have a implicit base, kind of like websites do, where there's the document base URI. Node has it essentially set to the process current working directory for those.
So
I just wanted to double check that that Bradley, the behavior you're describing is consistent with the call to the host hook here, providing null for the referrer in this case, because the current directory is not based on the referrer, it's based on the absence of a referrer.
Yes, but we use undefined instead of null. Either one works.
Okay.
Our API is considered experimental and we can alter it.
But. Okay, we should decide whether it's null or undefined. I'm happy with either one, but we should decide. We should not be ambiguous between two bottom values.
At least from the TC39 perspective, you're likely going to have an argument for undefined since it, if it does have a defaulting value. In other words, Jordan in particular is likely to argue if it is an optional parameter, it should default to undefined.
Mm-hmm. And in the host hooks for doing the refer relative resolution, we put the refer argument second. So it's natural to make it a optional parameter in the reified host hook. So I as well would prefer undefined. Kariti, did you have a reason to prefer null?
I copy null from some of the existing code, I think, from the spec. I don't remember, but I believe it should be neither of those.
Oh.
So if I have to take a position, my position is that it should be passed as a value, as Jordan suggests.
Can I just clarify one thing?
Sure. Yes.
So we're talking about two arguments, a specifier and a referrer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So I ran into this problem with the new URL constructor, like when you new a URL. I think they rely on number of arguments, like, you know, arguments.length. And if you pass undefined, I can't remember the specifics, but it was maybe a year ago that I was actually forced to have a conditional statement. If it's undefined, you know, just pass the specifier only. And if it's not undefined, then pass the two arguments. So at least we want to also consider why they have it that way. If it is that way everywhere, if there's, you know, something about using the number of arguments.
I'm fine with a value as long as it is a completely illegal value as a specifier. The string value null would make me uncomfortable.
So I just took a look at the issue itself to see what Jordan said. Jordan was advocating null. Why, Kariti, why would you like something that's neither null nor undefined?
So he was saying,
there.
Should it be an optional parameter passed to these? This is the first question. And he's saying, otherwise, I just suggest no.
Right. I think
one might be better, and I can explain the why.
Oh, okay. We should definitely discuss that. Yeah.
So the reason why I feel that this one should be provide, and you could certainly pass null if you want to, is that you will be able to do something like this.
Yeah, the problem is that this enables you to speak for another module. It's saying, if I were that module that is not importing something, but if I were that module, and I were importing something, then what would I get? I mean, then, you know, then that's what I want. So you're invoking the refer relative behavior without being the refer.
There is a little bit of prior art of doing stuff like that, both with the web and Node and designs for import meta resolve, where you can impersonate location.
I would prefer not to.
I would agree.
Okay. Is there some compelling use case, or is it just that this seems like flexibility someone might want for something? Because if motivation is not stronger than that, I would rather prevent impersonation.
Yeah, I feel that for me is that if you don't have something like this, then the user has to deal with two main issues. First one is the resolution on the resolution of the final URL in browser, for example. So you have to do something to resolve that URL based on the current script, if that's what you want, or any other URL that you have in mind, you have to resolve it to have the final URL before you call import on it. And that itself is hazardous because it has multi-platform issues and such. And then the second issue is obviously that if you don't, it's just hassle for people to assume that this import works just like the other import when it doesn't, and then they get confused about what this is supposed to do.
So with regard to the the import expression, if that's the other import you're referring to,
yes.
The import expression does not have an optional second argument. It's the refer is implicit in who's saying it. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I have a question about that. If you just use the indirect eval function, open paren, one comma eval, close paren, open paren, quote, import. So that'll already be an indirect eval. And then, right, good. And then something, yeah. So in that case, what gets provided as the refer?
The base.
The script that you're evaluating, which is the eval script.
The script that you're evaluating is the string that's the argument to the eval script.
Yeah, it doesn't have a URL. I believe you will get the current.
So every script does have a URL, at least in Node and in web browsers.
Okay, yeah, so in
it
Node.
It will get the current, in the browser, it will get the current page, I believe.
Yeah, the base of the page, yes. I actually use that pattern in some of my testing.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's, so that would again be it's being provided by the host hook based on the absence of something being provided to the host hook. It's right, I mean, it's because the host hook was invoked not providing a referrer that the host provided the base associated with the page.
I think it also has to do with this being the default. Like at some point, scripts also did not have a relative resolution behavior, but obviously that was very early on. And basically, they added the contextual referrer to scripts to mitigate this. So if eval did not get that upgrade, then it would just be the default behavior of, since there's no contextual referrer, default to the environments referrer or the root referrer or the base.
But my point is not whether it defaults, but who's doing the defaulting. It shouldn't be, it's not the language that's figuring out the default, because the language doesn't know that default value to provide it. It's the host that provides the default when the host hook is invoked omitting refer information. It's now the host knows that it needs to fall back.
Yeah, that's accurate. Even when you do a detached iframe and you call import, you try to do something like this where you are evaluating some import, it will say, well, I don't have a host to define where you anchor to, so I cannot resolve anything.
That was the exact test, by the way, yes.
Okay.
So good. That's the browser context not being active in order for it to have a referrer. I in the past I used to think of this as, we have context of a script or a module or whatever that is inside the context of the you know, the current realm. And the current realm defines something that could be overloaded by the context of the script or the module. So this is why I thought it was, it falls back to that which is defined if it doesn't have one defined for it. You know what I mean? I'm not sure if that, if resolving that referrer from the contextual, you know, using the contextual hierarchy is how it happens before or after the call is actually handled as a host import.
For Node, you must delegate to get the defaulting behavior. So okay. It is not so, automatic. There is two separate steps.
Okay, yeah, that answers it, I guess.
The thing, so obviously the compartment evaluator API will provide some sort of a mechanism to control this resolution, I suspect.
Right, it's going to provide the host hook, the host import hook, that takes a referrer as a second argument. And that's where, and that's the one where, one could define it such that the second argument was defined as optional, but whether but that's mostly a syntactic matter. In either case, what would be provided as the second argument would be, null or undefined or something, and then it's up to the host hook, which is per compartment, which can be bound per compartment, to decide what the behavior is when the host hook gets invoked with an absent refer.
So can we, can I just do devil's advocate just very, very quickly? So I understand that this is how the runtime prefers to implement it. Could we say that this being first class JavaScript code, it has JavaScript behavior, developers may prefer that it behaves like JavaScript it inherits, as opposed to the additional hook, and that throwing people off and having to understand why one hook is doing it one way and the other is doing it a different way.
I'm not understanding the suggestion.
I think what he's suggesting is a discussion that we have a while ago, Mark, on whether or not the realm should be considered a normal or a portable solution versus a non-portable solution. And whether or not if you're doing something with the realm, is whatever you do with that API, you can port it from one environment to another and it works the exact same way. And I think we settled on the idea that the realms, that this is a no-goal of the realm, of giving you the portability aspect of it. That's a hazard that you have on the language anyway. And the realm should not try to mitigate that in any significant way.
So you're referring to the fact that the realm API has decided to delegate all of the host hook issue to the compartment API.
Not necessarily that. Just the fact that, for example, the intrinsics that you're going to get are intrinsics that are defined by the environment and they can change over time. And whether or not you get the annex V attached to it or not, that's TBD. But I feel that we settle on the idea that it's not a goal for us to provide a solution that is portable.
Well, I think we're saying the same thing in different ways. So let me say it in my way and you can tell me. With regard to the goal of host virtualizability, so that on any host, JavaScript code can act as any other host to other JavaScript code, that in order to do that, everything that the JavaScript language normally delegates to the host, we need to provide some kind of host hook mechanism so that that delegation instead goes to the JavaScript code that's emulating the host. And it used to be that we were thinking that the host hooks that are about the nature of the realm, that are at the realm granularity, would be something that the realm API would provide the hooking for. And the ones that were at the compartment or the value evaluator granularity, the compartment API would provide the hooks for. Then two meetings ago, I think it was, Kariti really wanted to move all of the realm hook behavior into the compartment API so that it was, when you created a compartment, there was a per compartment realm constructor, so that when you use the realm constructor that was created as part of creating a compartment, and then you use that to create a realm, the host hooks for the created realm would start off delegating back to the host hooks of the compartment whose realm constructor that was. Boy, that was a very hard thing to state. Kariti, first of all, did you follow that?
Yes.
And second of all, am I successfully capturing our agreement?
Yes, but I don't think that's what Salad is asking about.
Okay. Well, I mean, it certainly put the right words for me to use. Suppose we're saying compartments are where you do magic with hooks. Even though realms have the capacity to divert or delegate hooks to compartments, having realms also have a way to overwrite the hooks may be introducing too many moving parts. That was my point. So for realms, hook things have a default behavior. And if the code is inside a compartment, the default behavior would be to delegate to the compartment if it has a hook. And then that means all your hooks are compartment things. And if you don't want to use a compartment, I don't know if that's going to be part of the final game, but if you're running just in the realm, it's behaving in a way that it's just delegating to the, you know, no hooking basically at this point. Everything is just running inside the realm. So does that kind of make more sense, or is it more watery?
Right. I think let's get back to the original problem and see if we can work from there, because I feel that we're drifting into a different conversation. I feel that if, based on what you said, which is the same mental model that I have, if you really want to control the default behavior or the default referral by doing something like this, you must create a compartment in order to control that. The other option that you have is that you have to do this. If you want to continue using the default behavior, if you want to ignore the default behavior, you'll have to do something like this, where you construct that thing, in which case you don't necessarily need a referral at all to resolve this URL. So you must do this by yourself.
Those two answers are compatible, correct?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
So if you do this, by default, it will go on and figure out whatever the environment is going to do for you. If that's not what you want, then you must do something like this, or you could create a compartment to control it.
Right, but in the option three case, it would still go to the host hook.
Yes.
It's just that the expected behavior of the host hook is to say, oh, this is an absolute specifier, mm-hmm. and therefore I don't care what the referrer is.
Yes, Correct.
Okay.
Well, something that is a little bit more flexible in the sense that I'm doing my own thing. I might just pass nothing here, but if I do want to provide my own resolution, I could do that and let the system to do the final resolution of the URL, which is problematic in many cases. So it feels to me that this option two, with this optional second argument, has as Jordan was suggesting, seems to be the more flexible one and the more simple one. And it works pretty well with the meta, import meta.
Yeah. So,
I really object to supporting option two because of the impersonation issue.
Okay.
So could I ask a question that doesn't come with a big pause?
Go ahead. No, I'm thinking here.
I think that was solid. Go ahead and ask your question while Caridi's thinking.
Yes.
So for example three, if this is a realm, and in my opinion, we're doing, yes, it hooks, it can delegate to compartments, but it's not a compartment. So that absolute URL has no rewriting. Is that correct? Or like, do you need to be in a compartment in order for you to influence what an absolute URL actually becomes as? Or does a realm also have like a module map or some sort of a way to define mapping an absolute URL to something else?
It does not have any of that. It delegates to the host, which could be a compartment around.
Right, okay. It delegates to the host. Yeah, so the compartment API, basically all of the flexibility that Caridi didn't need to be in the Realm API. Tell me if I'm oversimplifying, but Caridi delegated all of that flexibility as much as possible to the compartment API in order to simplify the Realm proposal itself.
Great.
Yes.
That's so part two of the question, and that's simpler. In case I wanted to overload an absolute URL in option three, then I would do c.import whatever, and that means that the Realm will, instead of delegating that to the runtime, it will delegate that to the compartments.
Host hook.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm
right.
Able to
enter right.
That. In a, perfect. Okay. Now I have the full picture. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. Yes.
Okay. So Mark. So I would drop this option two.
Okay. Great.
In favor of, let me explain my answer to this. Like answer to myself, so just we can answer this to other people. The fact that in order to keep these two to be equivalent, these two lines here to be equivalent, we should not have an extra argument that changes the resolution of the final URL, because you will not be able to do that if you use eval import.
Mm-hmm.
Because the eval import will just go directly to the host hook to resolve that thing. While in this one, we're sort of allowing impersonation and allowing all kind of different behavior because you're providing the referral. Okay.
Good.
Just a minor question. What's the return type on this API?
It's a namespace, promise namespace object.
Namespace object?
The promise of a namespace object.
So
yeah.
Is the that, same as
then it would not give you the namespace?
Say that again?
If I export function then, I would get the results of that?
If you export a function then...
If the namespace object is eventable. This is the bizarre edge case that...
But that's the same for regular modules, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, this is exactly the same code that we have in here. So this is not different from the import call.
That is not entirely... It for the import expression, that is true. That's not entirely true for static import.
It could be a getter function, like an arrow function that returns the promise to the namespace.
So I'm saying is, instead of just giving you the namespace directly, just wrap it in an object, and then it goes away.
So at this point, we're actually getting, there's sufficient overlap with the things I wanted to talk about in the presentation that I propose we switch to the presentation.
Right, okay, so I'll open an issue with the denable then, and we can have that. Last thing quickly before we jump into that, this one seems to be pretty okay. Pretty quickly, Mark, the recommendation from Jordan, which I agree with, is that instead of using a second argument object back with the type, if the type is going to be required, then just make it a second string argument that could be module or script, and then eventually you need an option back, could be a third argument. That's his recommendation. I do agree with that.
Okay, so I do not. I'm sorry. I agree with the if then, I suppose, because I disagree. I think the condition should be false. We should not require a type. It should default to strict indirect global code. Strict script indirect global code. There's one sensible default, and that's the one we should provide as a default.
So the strict or sloppy, we're not providing, at least up to this point, we're not providing such option.
I'm perfectly happy never to provide a sloppy option. If they want sloppy, they have the eval function on the global. They can sloppy away. A new API that we're providing should not support sloppy.
Could we make it programmatically clear, though? Because people will assume, maybe make a type sloppy that basically delegates to the global object. Just make it declaratively clear that this is different from not evaluating in a realm.
I would prefer not to. I think that there's just, I think we should just directly support strict script only.
And so just to resolve the ambiguity, maybe just rename it to strict script as the string so people won't be as confused. And then... People can argue for sloppy, but I somewhat agree. They can already get a hold of sloppy. And I cannot think of a reason people should be using sloppy mode these days.
Okay. And the nice thing about defaulting to strict script eval code is that top-level declarations in strict script eval code do not get aliased to the global. They remain local to that evaluation.
There is one use case for sloppy if you're emulating console evaluations. So if we're going to say we're going to provide this as a way to virtualize runtimes, you might want to actually not have to rely on an inspector interface on the process or, you know, the dev tools. You might want to actually emulate dev tools with the
realm. I sure wish that any REPL I interact with, including the console, I certainly wish it were strict. So new things like a console should be encouraged to be strict. And we're not taking sloppy support away from them. We're just not providing them a new way to do sloppy.
Then maybe type console?
There's type repo that Google is actively working on these days.
What the hell is that?
I proposed it like 2 years ago because there were no rules for how repo should work. They're just trying to clarify how variables and things work for consoles.
Okay.
It's not terrible. The only interesting thing about it is there are arguments about this lexical contour that all the repos introduce. So.
Yeah.
So I feel that So one thing is the idea world that we want to live on. One very different thing is the reality that we live on. And there will be many cases in which you do want to create a ROM to evaluate a library that you don't trust that happens to be in a script that requires sloppy mode. That's the reality that we live on. Any library that is trying to access the global disk by using the function
And we're not taking away the global eval function.
No, that's true. We're not taking away, but then you have to go and do some extra magic if it happens that you want to use some of those. And so that's why I'm opposed to have a default value. So my first opposition is to have a default behavior. I feel that you should be, because it's just a foot gun. You might attempt to evaluate a module and you don't pass the type that you want, and it evaluates and it works, and then you make a change in that code and it doesn't work anymore. So I'd rather prefer people to have an explicit definition there saying, this is what I'm trying to evaluate. This is a powerful evaluator that I'm giving to you. Make sure that you use it with the proper values when it comes to calling and evaluating code. So being explicit there is a feature, I believe, rather than having a default behavior. That's my first objection. And then the second one is that you have now two different ways to evaluate a script. One is by using evaluate with the type of script or a structured script or whatever the value is. And the other one is that you have to do eval, catch it, call eval, which is indirect eval, obviously, but it doesn't matter because it's global evaluation.
Can I add the third concern I have? And just the fact that if you're going to write realm-oriented JavaScript, and basically you know that there's sometimes you're going to have to overreach and just circumvent the realm and do something with the global eval, that will encourage people to do that. And the more people do that, the more, you know, like you don't need to do anything to code that is intended to be evaluated as sloppy in the global. There's nothing you need to do about it now. But if one day you need to do something about it and the pattern had been encouraged that people overreach, we don't know how much they would like to do that.
We're doing it in order to discourage it, not in order to encourage it.
I would frame it differently than that even. So it isn't, I do not frame this as a means of discouraging people to do this. I would say we just are not providing a convenience because we are wary of the convenience. So if we do provide it, that is what we should be talking about, I feel. So if we were to provide a way to do sloppy stuff from an external means, this is the Realm API, it is external to the code inside the Realm itself, that means that you could inject sloppy code into an otherwise completely strict Realm. I am not super comfortable with that just because right now we have a way to effectively prevent there ever being sloppy mode code run within a realm. If we introduce this API as an external means to inject code in sloppy mode, we can no longer do that. Does that make sense?
You're yeah. saying that because you can create you can eval code that creates a new realm and runs sloppy there.
So right now, if we only provide a way to inject to evaluate a strict script mm-hmm. or a module, we are guaranteed that any external evaluation into the realm using this API, realm.evaluate, will always be strict. So this is important-ish to me because that means at any point in time, I can rest assured the only way to get sloppy code in my realm is from the realm itself. So if I snapshot this realm or something in a way that it could not create sloppy mode code internally, I can be guaranteed for all the future, it will never obtain sloppy mode code within itself. That would not be true if realm.evaluate provided a sloppy option.
And you're planning to take away the sloppy capability by removing eval, or how do you
plan? I'm saying we could allow people to remove the sloppy ability through whatever means. Removing eval is part of the options. But if we
if you're going to change eval by putting a new eval that is indirect and is strict, by adding use strict at the beginning or something like that, isn't that equivalent to going and change your evaluate function to guarantee that it's only allowing you to call with a strict or forces to use a strict when you try to evaluate any script? Isn't the same thing?
Roughly, but from a usage perspective, I would be uncomfortable with that transform because then people will explicitly use type sloppy script, but then I will have made it so that that doesn't work. Instead of doing something internal in the realm itself, I have to have the realm effectively perpetually guard against something. Rather than removing a capability, I have to guard every attempt to get access to that capability forever.
Maybe I should just add an example of what I think is going to be problematic here. So if we make the realm API so difficult to use for people to transition from whatever they're doing today into the realm API, that for me is a problem. Like, let's say I have an application, a web app that uses a script to load a library, and I don't trust a library and I wanted to load the same library inside a realm or something like that to do some operations there. That library happens to be a sloppy. So now I have to do a fetch to get the source, to evaluate the source using eval. I can use evaluate directly because the thing is in a sloppy script, but the transition from a script tag to a realm to evaluate, fetch and evaluate is on itself a...
So I want to question the premise of the sloppy mode library, particularly in the presence of Webpack, Babel, and others, all automatically converting everything to strict. Do we have a prime example of where this is important?
Well, any library that has been created in the last 5 years or so that is using the function constructor to find the global list, that's a sloppy in itself. It's a sloppy wrapper with the strict content of the library inside.
I don't believe any of the modern wrappers do that anymore because it fails CSP.
You'll be surprised.
So even if that is the case, I'm going to question it and say that we can reevaluate adding that as needed. But right now, we would effectively be making it prohibitively hard to prevent sloppy mode code from appearing within a realm by providing that API.
Another thing I don't understand about what Caridia is showing is, what does evaluate string, comma, type module mean? What does it do? What does it mean to evaluate code as a module?
That's the top level parse goal.
Yeah, this one.
But okay, I understand what it means to parse it. I understand what it means to take an entire, an entire module import graph and load it, instantiate it, link it, and initialize it. Is the idea there that this module source code is the start module of an entire module graph?
Oh, wait, you're talking about evaluate a script, or you're
talking about the thing you were showing a moment ago, evaluate open paren some string, comma, open curly type colon module.
Oh, module. Module is just the same as this one here.
And what is that?
That is what, roughly what you have described. Yes, you have, you get a source, you're going to parse that as a module, and then you're going to call it for the linking phase and eventually for the evaluate phase.
Okay,
you're going to get the namespace back.
Okay, so evaluate does the full transitive module, obtaining the modules and linking and instantiating them and initializing them.
The link happens before the evaluate, but yes.
Okay, and does evaluate return a namespace object, or does it return a promise for a namespace
object? A promise for a namespace object, because the evaluation might have a top level await.
And the module itself, because you provided it by a string, cannot be named. Is that correct?
The module itself cannot be named.
It doesn't have a module name because it didn't appear, it wasn't obtained by looking up a name. You provided the module source code directly.
Right, this is equivalent to a script type module in a browser. You don't have a way to access that.
I see. Script type module, okay.
So we should be wary about comparing things to script tag. The type module does not actually declare using the module goal in browsers. It just changes the evaluation mechanics. So it's also used for WebAssembly.
I didn't get that.
So script type equals module can point to a source that's WebAssembly, is the ongoing direction. It is not, so we just should not compare this to script tags.
So let me see if I can short circuit some of the controversy here. The thing that I feel strongly about is that it should default to the simple, sane option. And in fact, in the typical TC53 scenario, that's the only one we're going to support anyway, because in the TC53 scenario, it doesn't make sense for evaluate to support any of the other cases. But we are proposing that evaluate take an options bag, so we can still provide options for evaluating things as module code. We can provide options. We can, you know, if we decide to do it, we can provide an option for evaluating it as sloppy. And then environments like SES that don't in which sloppy is not a viable choice can simply error if the sloppy option is turned on. If the options bag says evaluate sloppy, it can just, you know, error, we're not supporting that on this platform. But so we can still do what, you know, so the issue about what degrees of flexibility we want to support by the options bag is something that's a separate argument. The thing that I want to emphasize is that there's a sensible default, and that default is in fact the only thing we're planning to support in CESS, the only thing that XS plans to support, the only thing we're specifying in the compartment API. So let's just agree on that as the default, and then having a default that doesn't have an explicit type provided, we can then agree that the second argument is the options bag.
Can you clarify if there would be any problems if we did have an options bag that only had one valid value for those engines?
Ask the whole question again.
If we did not provide a defaulted value, if we did require a call to provide the type of evaluation being performed, would that be problematic even if there was only one valid value for the host?
It would be problematic only from a human factors perspective, which is, why am I repeatedly saying this boilerplate when it's the only choice that's supported anyway?
Right, but remember, if I get some library that is creating a ROM and evaluating into that ROM, and it's being explicit about what type of evaluation they want, they do a strict script or something like that.
Okay.
Now you bring it into your system. You're not using it in a browser, but you're using it in a hardware directly. It works fine because you're specifying that, and that's what it supports. But if you bring a library that's doing module there, what does that mean? Is it going to throw an error?
Is
module allowed, or is not even allowed?
So this is something we can obviously revisit and discuss. But so far, all of the discussions about CESS and TC53 and the compartment API, including supporting CESS on, you know, within full JavaScript, the only evaluation that we've been discussing and that has been on the table for many, many months now has only been evaluate source text, comma options, where there was no module option and there was no sloppy option. So if there was if you provided a type module or a type sloppy or whatever, then yes, it should throw an error.
I find that weird, because we're moving into a direction where everything is a module. I have demos and examples and all kind of things that are only modules, and they never use a script. It's not even built to a script anymore. It's not even rolled up into a script. It's just a module. Mm-hmm. So I just cutting out all that from use. Being useful in this other system is going to be tricky. So I think that modules will be something that they will have to support. And then the question is, well, if module is supported, it's not that that's the only option, but it's the option that module is also supported, then does that change the equation?
Okay, so you're, first of all, the emphasis on SES has been modules. And in the typical TC53 configuration, including right now already the typical XS configuration, is it actually doesn't support scripts at all. It only supports modules. And therefore, in that configuration, evaluate in that configuration would always throw an error because it's not how you bring modules into the system. The way you bring modules into the system is that this is the two-phase issue that we talked about, which is that there's one phase that goes from module source code to what we've been calling a static module record. And I think it corresponds to what Caridi's been calling a parsed module object, which is only separate, standalone, sort of pre-compiled information that represents what's derived from module source code, and that's linkable. When you're building for a device, you would basically pre-compile all the modules into module static records ahead of time, and then at runtime, you're instantiating those module static records into linked, initialized, instantiated a graph of linked module instances, and that's what the compartment API is about. That's the division we're making between the import hook, which would plug into the compartment API in a full JavaScript system, but it's the import hook that goes from obtaining module source code to producing a module static record, and then it's the compartment API that goes from module static records to linked module instances. And on the device, only that second phase would ever be happening in the normal device. Right, in the device, there is no JavaScript parser running in the device, so you can't go from module source code or script source code to execution. You can only go from pre-compiled modules to execution.
If that's the case, does it matter what types are supported here? Because then that would mean for those cases where you can't parse on your VM.
That's right. For that case, when you're running with no parser, then evaluate is completely dead anyway. So it doesn't matter for that case which one it supports. That's true. The next more capable configuration that we've been engineering for that fits into the larger language is an evaluate that defaults at least to strict scripts. And I'm open to being able to ask it to evaluate a module and for whether the module is supported being dependent on the virtual or actual host. But I still think that the strict script really is the sensible, simple default thing.
Okay, so yeah, I want to continue hijacking the call. Let me add some comments into the pull request and get some feedback from other people. And we can chat about it next week for a resolution. Good.
Okay, so I'm going to go back to the presentation and actually touch on some of these same issues. as they appear in the presentation. Okay, and everybody seeing the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, good. So the analogy I'm making that at least helps me think about it, I hope it helps others think about it, is that in the way we run our machines, when one process controls another, when one process sets another process up, so the other process has some kind of limited access and environment, it's not done just through trapping. It's also done through mapping of names. So virtual addresses, when a virtual address maps to a physical address, where the physical address is backed by a physical memory page, then it's setting up the MMU, the mapping, the address translation is the way in which one process controls another and gives the child process limited access. And then there's also a separate mechanism, which is the MMU providing the faulting and the operating system potentially enabling those memory faults to be reflected back to the controlling process, where when the child process touches a virtual address that doesn't map to a physical page, it causes a trap to some trap handler that another user code can provide, the one emulating a host, that then the result of the trap is a new physical page of memory that comes from wherever. It might be calculated by the trap handler, but once it's provided, now the map successfully maps to it. So the analogy I want to make is that in the compartment API, a compartment is running with an import namespace. And when one compartment makes another, it provides a module map, mapping from names in the child to names in the parent. And the names in the parent might correspond to module static records that are already present, or it might correspond to a module that needs to be fetched from some external source. And that may have to be asynchronous, speaking about sort of not in the TC53 specific context, but the larger language context. So we want to accommodate all those degrees of flexibility, but separate the issue of doing the namespace mapping from the issue of doing the trapping. And then furthermore, the namespace mapping has to compose. So the child doesn't know that it's not the parent. So whatever the parent can do to set up a child, the child should be able to do to set up a grandchild. But the child can only give the grandchild things that the child itself has. Now going to, let's see, I think I can pretty much go to the end of the talk here. Okay, let's just focus in on this slide, which has both the proposed API over here and the proposed internal semantic state. So to get from the existing spec to compartments, the thing in the existing spec that now has the tremendously unfortunate name of realm record, unfortunate because it's now has nothing to do with realms, it has everything to do with compartments. But we just turned that from an internal explanatory spec object into a reified exotic object, which is the compartment instance. So a compartment instance would exactly be something that has these internal slots. And the first five slots here are exactly the five slots that are defined already in the realm record. And then we would add two more slots, which is the module map that's the serves the internal mapping purpose, but that's calculated from the module map argument here in the realm constructor, and the correspondence between these two is what's interesting. And the options bag for the compartment constructor that's where the host hooks would show up. And the two host hooks of interest, I'll flip back a couple slides and then flip forward again. The two host hooks of interest, which turn out not quite to be adequate, but this is what I presented at TC53. Peter spotted what's inadequate here, but it's basically the synchronous hook and the asynchronous hook. Those are both actually host hooks in the existing ECMAScript spec. And obviously the synchronous hook could only produce a static module record when that static module record is already available synchronously. So anything that needs the synchronous hook would fail if something was asked for that's not synchronously available. And then the asynchronous hook, that's the thing that's invoked for example, the import expression. And that hook can provide a promise for a static module record that at some future point resolves to a module static record. So that's what the hook provides. And then the module static record is then instantiated in the context of this compartment. And that instantiation and initialization is where the module static record turns into a module instance specific to this compartment. And it's that module instance that has the module namespace object that's returned from the import expression. So what we're proposing as well is that this import method on the compartment instance is essentially the same, I mean, is the same, I think, as the import method on the realm instance that we now agreed to. But there's also an import now that invokes the synchronous hook that's only satisfiable for things that are synchronously accessible. What that produces, So inside the hooks here would be both the now hook and the asynchronous hook. For TC53 audience, only the now hook is actually of interest. A system in which there was just the asynchronous import hook for getting code started in a compartment was a non-starter with Patrick from Modable. Because they have, you know, they don't want to pay for that. That asynchrony is just completely irrelevant to them, and it's painful. So this thing about the module map, what I've done so far is explain the name-to-name mapping, and having that name-to-name mapping where it's child name to parent name, and that looks up in the parent namespace, the internal static module record in order to populate the module map of the child. Now, the interesting issue that I especially want to touch on with Bradley on the call is there's the issue we keep coming back to about this mapping over here. Is that mapping provided by a data mapping, which is what's the case in Modelable right now, or is it provided by a function that's invoked that whose results are memoized so that the function is never asked the same question twice? And in a previous call and this question comes up not just for this mapping. So I don't want to just focus on this mapping. The other place it comes up is this mapping down here in, I'm sorry, not this mapping here, in the hook. Right, I'm sorry, the import hook, this mapping over here, the hook will typically want to be a function, but the tension is that Bradley brought up is because of the way Node is providing extensibility, the function is going to be much more expensive than the data. Bradley, am I getting that right?
I mean, yes, but okay. It will save space. Computationally, okay. Much more expensive. Memory-wise, much less.
Okay. Right now, Modelable is supporting only data, and when all the information relevant is known up front, being able to write it down as a simple name-to-name mapping has a simplicity in how you express it in the code. So the thing I want to propose as something, you know, as a design to consider every time this tension comes up is to be able to provide both, where you provide the data and you optionally provide a function that is only invoked when the data misses. And that the thing that's provided here as an explicit argument would just be the data to data mapping, so you can write it simply. And the Modelable experiments actually show how pleasant that is. And then the function that backs this one up to handle the cases where the data mapping misses would be provided as yet another options in this option bag.
Yeah, what I mentioned last week when we talk about some of these, I was saying, well, if the hook is a function, you could still implement an static map that is returned by that is used by that function to resolve something the first time that it's asked for. And then you can just have a single option that is always a function. But seems that you're providing a low-level API and a high-level API on the same option box. That seems weird.
Yes.
So this is not so weird to me, at least. So our default is always going through functionality that is evaluated code. The policy files explicitly don't allow that in Node. When you enable a policy, it must have a full static resolution. So we do have that kind of odd dichotomy already.
Okay, so you would be receptive to the idea of data plus an optional function for handling data misses.
That seems perfectly fine.
Good. Good. And the reason, and the reason for just bringing the module map out here as a parameter and having that be only data is that the simple examples are expressed so simply and pleasantly if you do that. And then you have no loss of generality for the basically it's the old Alan Kay saying, simple things should be simple, complex things should be possible. And the function for handling the misses is all in the area of complex things should be possible.
That seems fine to me.
Okay. Another issue
My only comment there is that in general, this API is very, very low level. And the fact that many of these are very low level APIs and you're just introducing one plus an API for the general case seems like
Okay, when you say it's low level, it's a pleasant API when used directly to getting things done. I mean, sometimes the implication of low level, for example, I would say proxies are low level, which is anything interesting you want to do with the proxy, you would first carefully construct a library for using the low-level proxy API to do some high-level goal, then only use it through the library because proxies are so tricky. I think there certainly will be libraries for doing certain patterns, like the tofu configuration pattern, that wrap the compartment API. But it's also the case that just using the compartment API directly, Modible showed that it's actually more pleasant than I expected.
Well, for me, this API, the compartment API, is at the same level as the proxy in terms of complexity, trickery, foot guns, and such. You have to understand what you're doing to use the compartment API.
The simple use doesn't have, I would claim that the simple use, let's say, where you're only using the first two arguments, the endowments and the module map, and in the module map, let's say you're only using the name-to-name mapping because I haven't even explained the namespace part yet. We'll come back to the namespace. I think that one's going to be fine as well. But let's ignore that for now. If you're just using endowments and the module map as a name-to-name data mapping, and you're not providing any options, then where's the foot gun? I think it just does what you think it does, and it does it reliably and safely.
So if you don't provide a hook for one of the capabilities or one of the host APIs, what is the default behavior of that?
If you completely leave off the options object, then it defaults to the host hooks of the compartment from which this compartment constructor. Right. I mean, it's basically exactly the same issue that we came up with for Realms, mm-hmm. which is every time you create a compartment, you get a new compartment constructor. Mm-hmm. So if you leave off the options bag when calling the compartment constructor, it defaults to the host hooks associated with the compartment that this compartment constructor came from.
Okay, so if I pass only the module map and I try to load a module that is not part of that module map, and I didn't pass the function to resolve unknown module names, what happened? Like, is it going to throw an error, or is it going to go to the outer host to try to resolve it?
It will throw an error.
Yeah, that's my foot gun there.
Why is that a foot gun?
Because you have to ask the question of what's going to happen. While if we say, well, the only way you have to control the module is by providing the function, you know, that function has to give us an answer, whether that answer is throwing an error or give us something to go and get it.
Throwing the error fails safe. and it fails in the same way for the same case every time.
No, I agree with that. I agree that the throwing the error is probably the safe bet here. It's just that the question that as a developer I have to ask myself when I'm writing this API is the shotgun. Because some people will assume that, well, no, it should work.
If it reliably fails during development, such that you fix it during development, I would not classify that as a shotgun.
So what happened if I do a import with a dynamic value for the module specifier that when I'm testing this in development, with different data, it might work, but then it doesn't work anymore. So that's a kind of, because you
If you provide a name-to-name mapping, and then during development, you never test it with a name that's not in the mapping, and then at runtime, you provided a name that is not in the mapping, then there will be a runtime failure that didn't happen in development. But that's just sort of the normal coverage hazard, which is
it's not intermittent failure.
Okay.
I get that part. I get that this is a safe bet.
Okay.
The problem for me is that you have to ask the question.
Okay. There's a surprise here. I'm just saying it's not a foot gun.
Okay.
Can I ask a related question?
Yeah.
So what is the expected behavior if you intend for the content or the module, the code running in a compartment to not have access to a particular module? The mapping provides mapping for modules you do intend the compartment to have access to. What is the behavior if the compartment tries to access a module that you intend it not to have access to?
It throws. And that's exactly what I was trying to illustrate with this diagram, where the child is not granting to the grandchild yellow. In fact, the grandchild has no names for yellow, but the grandchild only has a name for brown and purple. And if it tries to say anything else, then it gets an error.
So then that sounds like if you don't implement the function, it's very much expected behavior and not a foot gun, in the sense that if you don't provide a compartment with access to a certain module, then it's as if you implemented that function and explicitly told it that you know the return value from the function is that there's no module. That makes sense. So whether you implement the function or not is irrelevant. It doesn't change the foot gun. There's really no foot gun.
Okay, good. By the way, just curious, are you calling us, are you talking to us from the plane?
Actually, I boarded and then there was a problem with the air conditioning on the aircraft. So I've gotten off again and we'll probably board again soon.
So I have another question, and this diagram is exactly the right place to answer it. Which was you walked through this analogy to an MMU, where you have a mapping table and then a page fault trap for references that aren't at the table, and I was unclear since that mapping this illustration in your talk. And the API specification that we were on just a few minutes ago, the API that you presented is exactly this pattern, which is you have a mapping table, and then you have a trap handler for when you fault an entry, attempt to access an entry that's not in the table.
Yes.
And when you were originally talking about this, I thought this was about module loading, and realizing that I'm confused about whether we were originally talking about the actual loading of a module or simply the name mapping.
So the so in the API up here, we're only doing a name-to-name mapping. And now there's what we presented with regard to what the hooks are was actually too simple. We had the import now hook be from specifier and refer directly to static module record. And Peter said, well, you know,
Okay. I think I can clarify my question then,
okay.
Which is you have this pattern which is parallel to the page faulting with an MMU, and then you've got this API. Am I correct in seeing that you actually have two separate occurrences of that pattern in this design? You have the, I need to load the module, I don't have the module, oops, I better go get the module. And I need to map this name to something, oops, I don't have a mapping, I better call this function to compute the mapping.
So I think the answer is yes. And this falls into the area where what we presented, what you're seeing on the slide is too simple.
Right. Because here you've got you've got two different hooks. And I'm genuinely confused about what the division of responsibility between them is.
Okay. So one of the things that became clear and which relates to the thing that Peter spotted is that this is the discussion chip that you were in on yesterday. Is that forget about data versus function for a moment. Just let's talk about mapping names to names. There's actually two different namespace mappings that we need in resolving module imports with regard to compartments. And that is the mapping that you see up top here, ignoring whether it's done by data or function, but just this is child name to parent name. And that's what's also reflected on the MMU analogy diagram, is just child name to parent name. And that's how you get that's how you get from one compartment to another. And then there's the completely within a compartment mapping from specifier and refer to module name, where refer is one of those, you know, is the kind of module name that is also the output of that mapping. So not a static module record, but rather a string and string to string, where this string, the specifier string, is just the string that appears in an import statement. This string is after all, you know, the after all of the relative, you know, the dot dot slash processing is done. Everything that's kind of refer relative, once that's all done, what's left over is a module name that's relative to the compartment, but is no longer relative to a refer. So the refer itself is of that type, and the output of this function is of that type. So we need both of those name-to-name mappings. At one point, we thought we could combine both of those name mappings into one, which is something that goes from specifier and child referrer name to parent module name. So it's doing both
I understand that there are two mappings.
Okay. Those mappings, and so the first mapping, child name to parent name, is something that having it normally be provided mostly with data, I think is compelling, because it'll be a policy decision what the mapping is. I think the refer relative specifier resolution will generally be provided by algorithm. There will generally be a default algorithm for that.
Because it has to do things like path canonicalization and the like, which is computational.
Right.
Okay. All right. Okay. That makes sense. All right. Carry on.
I think I've...
One quick second. Michael Hunter has his hand up, and so does Bradley.
Oh, hands up. Wow.
I did that a while back. let me pick it up again.
No, I'm very glad you're doing that. I just never have used that feature of Zoom before. I wasn't really aware of it. So please, Michael, go on.
No, don't worry. I vocalized my question and then forgot to put my hand down again.
Okay. So Bradley, thanks. You have your hand up.
So I did have a question, if it's been talked about. Has there been discussion about the interaction of timing between import now and import?
So there are in this spec right now, there's already, in terms of the internal host hooks, there are both hooks.
Correct, but they are not currently observable in the same manner. So my concern here is if we perform import, not import now, and we obtain a promise and we can import now to get the result of the promise before the promise has been able to fire a handler.
Mm-hmm.
So that would change our ability to mutate a namespace or invoke parts of a namespace in such a way that they could no longer be guaranteed that any promise handler has the first opportunity to do so. And yeah. This came up as an important distinction about polyfills and built-in modules, that if you are able to obtain a promise for a built-in module and you are able to do it first, you are guaranteed the first right of essentially punching it.
What does punching it mean?
Monkey punching, mutating it in odd ways.
The static module record is static and immutable. It is not a module instance. And then the static module record gets...
Oh, I see. I was confused. I still have some questions, but I need to think on that more.
Your question is still puzzling. Even with this being limited to just static module records where there's no issue of mutating, there's still the issue of if both hooks are provided and you already have a request, an asynchronous request in the air, and then the synchronous hook gets called and provides an answer that disagrees with what will be the answer of the asynchronous hook. I don't know what to do. That's a good question. It's something we need to figure out.
I think there's also a question about relative timing there, which I think Bradley also raised, which is, and the way that popped into my head is if we start the asynchronous process of doing an import, and that promise gets resolved, at that point, after it has been resolved, will then the import now hook be able to get immediate access to it?
Right, and I've been, okay, let me try out a solution to both problems. The internal module mechanism isn't just directly invoking the hooks. The hooks have this memo in front of them. We always memoize their answers so that we never ask them the same question twice. And so now the way that I'd like to approach this question is to imagine that there's one memo in front of both hooks, but of course now the memo is a little complicated. So the same two requests can be made of the memo mechanism, but now the memo mechanism can impose consistency constraints around the behavior provided by the hooks. So if you're making a synchronous request that's not already in the memo, then it goes to the import now hook and the result gets memoized. That's the obvious case. If you make an asynchronous request of the memo, that it first tries to resolve it, tries to resolve it synchronously. So it first gives the import now hook a chance to satisfy it. And if the import now hook misses, only then does it invoke the import hook. And once the import now hook has missed, the import now hook has essentially committed to the miss under the policy that we're only asking each hook any question once. So now the import hook is only invoked when the import now hook has said it missed. And having said it missed, it's never going to be asked again, so it cannot give an inconsistent answer.
I'm less worried about inconsistency within a particular execution as a temporal inconsistency where you can have what amounts to a race, where if you do the asynchronous import hook and it goes about its business and resolves the promise.
Yeah.
And therefore puts an entry in the memo table. And right. Then at a slightly later time, the import now hook is called, and well, there's an entry there, so it returns it.
Yes.
Whereas if the import now hook.
I'm sorry. It's not the import now hook that would be called. There's a synchronous request of the memo mechanism.
Fine. That's neither here nor there with respect to the question I'm asking. But what I'm saying is there could be. If I do an import, a call to import now, and the thing is not there, then import now knows it's not there. If I do the asynchronous import, and mm-hmm. the asynchronous import has sufficient time to actually complete the importation before the import now is called, then if the import now were called at a later time, it succeeds. And because the timing of that promise resolution is potentially, it's a source of non-determinism, mm-hmm. you could get different behavior depending of the import now hook, depending on the timing of the import hook.
Can I make a suggestion that there should not be an import now hook? That if you want something imported now, you put it in the module map and be done with it?
I was gonna suggest the opposite, which is to allow promise in the module map, but I won't go into that now. I need to understand I need to understand all of this more. But yeah, can I raise one thing in conjunction with this discussion, which is that I don't know that these questions are specific to compartments. Are these not more general questions of if you're in a module just running in a web page or a node environment and you call import or you perform an import, what is the expected behavior?
So the specification in providing both host hooks says something about how they should be consistent with each other, and probably what we all need to do, including myself, is actually go back to the spec and see what the consistency requirements are on the genuine host. And then we should say that our memo mechanism simply enforces whatever the consistency is that the spec says the host must satisfy.
Yes, that's exactly what I was getting at.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's probably the right way to answer this question.
Well, I think the thing is the current import mechanism, dynamic import always gives you a promise, and static import is always static. And here, what you've done is you've introduced a hook to do a dynamic import of something which is statically resolved, and I think that's potentially problematic.
So you're certainly right that it's potentially problematic. What the spec says about the consistency requirement on the host has to take a position on this question.
And that's right. Are you talking about the current module system spec?
That's right.
Because I think what you've introduced is you've now introduced an opportunity. You've introduced a use case which is not even a possible thing in the current module semantics.
But I think that the question must map literally, because the current module semantics does provide to the host both a synchronous hook and an asynchronous hook. And it says something about requirements on the host such that its behavior with regard to the two hooks are consistent with each other.
Well, except that the spec is defining the behavior of the JavaScript engine, which is going to use those hooks in a particular way, whereas these hooks are being provided to user code, which might use them in a different way.
I think we're standing on the opposite side of that wall. Users don't call these hooks. Users provide functions which are these hooks.
You're right. You're right. You're correct. Yes.
And that it's still the same internal JavaScript module mechanisms.
Yes, no, I think I see the bug in what I was thinking there.
Okay.
I think you're right.
Okay. And the spec can simply state consistency requirements on the host that the host must satisfy. When we reify hooks so that user code can provide them, user code can provide code that does whatever. So we went through this with proxies. The internal methods that proxies reify into handler traps, the internal methods must have some consistency properties, like the object invariance. So then when we reify them into handler traps, we have to assume that the handler traps can do whatever, so that the mechanism that we go through, the proxy mechanism, in providing them as user traps, also has to do a consistency enforcement so that the handler having weird behavior cannot cause the proxy to violate the invariance.
Right. No, that's an extremely apt analogy. And I think that's the I think that satisfies my concern on that one. I mean, obviously it has to be understood better in order to describe to people how to implement these, to describe the mechanism that's going to use these hooks. But I think we're good in principle. Mm-hmm. Question.
It is way past 3. I'm going to, I propose that I turn off the recording.